Welcome to TV Crew Talk, hosted by Howie Zales. Conversations about the exciting careers of broadcast sports and entertainment professionals. Howie is an Emmy Award-winning camera operator with 25 years experience shooting broadcast sports at the highest network level. He has covered Super Bowls, Kentucky Derbies, Olympics, and even WrestleManias. In this podcast series, you will learn from insiders about the broadcast sports industry and how you can accelerate your career in this thrilling, fast-paced environment.
Today's guest has 25 years experience in television production and over 20 years shooting broadcast sports. Scott has many different skills and experiences, and today we'll take a deep dive into Scott Snell's long career. Welcome to TV Crew Talk, Scott.
Hey, Howie. Thanks very much. Glad to be here.
Hey, I really appreciate your time. You know, the show is called TV Crew Talk, so let's talk about your TV career. Why did you choose sports broadcasting? When and why?
Wow. Well, it may be easier to answer the question with this statement. I don't know that I chose sports broadcasting. I think it kind of chose me. But I started doing it on a pretty regular basis back in, 1993, 94. And it was interesting because I was working for a production company at the time. And it was a small independent production company, and I wanted to do nothing more. I wanted to do more news stuff. And it's funny, I had this mindset back then. It's like I really wanted to be a news shooter and stuff like that, and I wasn't really shooting news. I was doing independent production work. And then I got an opportunity from one of my early mentors, if you will, Don Prasuti, and I don't know if you know Don, I think you might, but he had to bail out on, oddly enough, a West Point football game. And he called me up one day and said, hey, I can't do this gig tomorrow or this weekend, whatever it was. Could you do it for me? And I'm like, sure. So that was kind of my indoctrination by fire into sports broadcasting. And I went there, I ran a handheld opposite side. I still remember my director's name was Lou Rinone, no relation to Charlie Rinone. And it was for, remember the game. I mean, it was Louisville versus Army. And I did the game. I was like, it was 2 days worth of work. We did a set day. We did a shoot day. And it was mind blowing to me. I'm like, wow, I can make money doing this. So that was all the carrot dangling from the end of the string, if you will, that I needed to get my interests going in that direction. And I remember it was probably whatever the turnaround time was for getting paid for it. But that check happened to be sitting next to a check that I got from my studio gig, my production company gig. And I was like looking at them both, and I'm like, I worked 2 days. This other check was like for a week and a half. And I'm like, if all I got to do is work 6 days a month, I can do, I can do this. So that's kind of what that was my true initial, I guess, indoctrination into sports broadcasting. And I'm a sports fan, you know, but I think over the years, some of the shooting in sports has taken the fan out of me, where there's some sports I absolutely love. Like I love the sport of baseball. Ask me how much I like shooting it. It's just like one of those things, you know, you have your favorite sports you like shooting, and you have some that, all right, you know, paying bills is a necessity, so I got to go and do these jobs. And it's, don't get me wrong, none of it is like, I hate it. I absolutely hate it. because I think we all that are in this business love what we do. And it's, I think in some ways it's the best kept secret.
I understand what you're saying. Cause you know, obviously I've shot for a long time and I don't watch sports on TV. I just can't get into it, but I got into sports broadcasting cause I love sports.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I totally understand what you're saying. I had a similar story. My first experience on my very first job was with, unfortunately, I'm kidding, Ted Flandreau, who's been on the show before. So all I had to do was run the triax backwards on the first time, and that was it. But, you know, we all got to start somewhere.
Yeah, absolutely. I would be lying if I didn't say even after years of doing it that I didn't run a triax backwards or not, you know, I mean, thank God for turnarounds. That's all I can say. But
so you were in TV already. You got into sports TV. When did you know it was television that was the path you were going to take? For me, it was high school. I took a class in like 11th grade. I knew instantly what I wanted to do. When did TV, you know, present itself to you?
It's a great question. And part of the uber long story that I won't go into today, and I think I might have told you bits and pieces of it in the past. I started out in the film / video end of things. And I had someone that decided to take me under his wing and teach me the business. And he was fortunately at the time making a transition from film to video. We're talking, you know, one chip cameras, you know, 3/4 inch beta, and you know, stuff like that, or beta and 3/4 inch stuff for edit. And it was fascinating. I didn't realize how much I liked doing that sort of thing until I got hired. I mean, I wasn't fortunate and smart like you and actually took courses on television. I, of all things, crazy story, I answered an ad in the Penny Saver of all things. And
that's crazy.
It was down in Austin, New York, and I went and I met this guy. His name was Don Cohen, and I didn't realize who I was sitting with until I think towards the end of the meeting, the end of the interview, which I thought I failed miserably because I had no experience in that line of work whatsoever. It just kind of by chance, I was looking for a new job. And so when I realized Don Cohen did like all the original American Express commercials with Carl Malden and Coke and Pepsi. But he was like a commercial DP and did really, really cool stuff. A lot of big budget commercials. So I guess the best way to equate that is that, you know, doing, you know, a 2-day or 3-day commercial shoot is like doing a huge Hollywood production, you know, crammed into 2 or 3 days, but, you know, 80 to 130 person crews and lots of money and lots of gimmicks and gadgets and things to get the job done. But I mean, it's, you know, just shooting beautiful stuff in such a much shorter amount of time. And I stayed with them for a couple of years very early on and got my chops. And this is no lie. I started out with him making $35 a week for gas.
Wow.
That is absolutely no lie. And I loved it so much. I mean, I had stuff in savings, so I was getting through it. And I remember I was getting ready to leave, and just because financially I couldn't float that boat anymore. And for 2 weeks I was kicking, how do I tell these guys? And I was like, I just got to do it. And I went in to talk to him, and we were on a dark day at the studio. And I went in to talk to him, and he goes, hey, what are you doing here? And I said, oh, came to talk to you. He goes, good, because I got to talk to you. And he goes, what? I said, well, you can go first. And so he leans back and pulls a check out of his desk and hands it to me. And I look at it and I said, what's this? And he goes, that's what you'll be making every week with us from now on. And I'm like, wow, thank you. And he goes, now, what'd you have to talk to me about? And I said, well, I just wanted to thank you for the opportunity you've given me here. Yeah, it was a really, it's like timing is everything. And right. I think the truth of the matter was that he appreciated how hard I had worked and didn't complain. It wasn't about the money for me. It was about the knowledge and the experience. I mean, let me be honest. It did a lot of times have to do with the money, but it was chasing that rainbow. It's like, you know, if I can learn enough and understand this business and be good at it, I'll be doing what this guy is doing someday, hopefully. And that kind of paved my way to get into the business. And then along with the dues paying I did with them, then there was a whole different set of paying dues.
In
the television end of things, you know, working local cable and things like that, until I got, you know, solidified with that independent production company.
So tell our audience, because our audience is kind of, you know, younger people just getting into the business. What is your craft? What do you do in the sports broadcasting business? What's your position? List some of the events you've shot. And I know you have some other businesses, which we'll get into in a little bit. But let's start at the, you know, with that.
Well, I guess the most popular position that I would hold is I'm a camera operator, camera technician, broadcast technician, or a camera operator as most affectionately known. And I, you know, I do pretty much any and every sport, you know, baseball, hockey. And of course I named the first one I like shooting least first, but baseball, hockey, NFL, you know, all college sports. I mean, you name it. I think I've shot cricket. I mean, some crazy, crazy stuff over the years. But that's what I do on a day in, day out basis. And whether I'm doing a regular hard camera, I don't do a lot of handheld anymore. I think, you know, your years catch up to you after a while and it just becomes more difficult. So we leave that up to the young bucks to do it. But, you know, I do have quite a passion for doing handheld. It's just, it becomes a liability after a while on your body. So, I wish I was still in the kind of shape I used to be when I was in my 20s. So those guys that are out there looking to get in, or gals, handheld's a great, great door opener for a lot of other positions too, because it really teaches you the nuance of shooting and framing and positioning, putting yourself in the right position to get the shots that are going to please your directors and producers.
You know, John Gonzalez from NBC, who used to work at NBC, yes, who I traveled a lot with, told me, because I was a handheld operator also, right, he said, think of it as like you're making a movie. If you take one step left or right, go down on one knee, put the camera over your shoulder even, how can you make a movie out of your shot instead of just standing there flat straight onto whatever or whomever you're shooting?
Right. I mean, and it's like, if you have the ability to fly your lens into any situation, I think that's how John just described it. I mean, your ability to be mobile with the device that you're using to capture the moment is huge. And, you know, perspective is everything. So having those angles, having the ability to tell the story with that less than flat perspective, get you into the moment. So as if you're there and a part of it, or, you know, or even as a fly on the wall type of perspective, I mean, it's everything. It, you know, if you can just look at an image, a moving image, and tell what's going on, without really even hearing it, just visually seeing what's going on, that's all part of storytelling and broadcast. I mean, whether you're shooting movies or you're shooting a sports broadcast, you're still telling the story. As a sports broadcast is unfolding, you have to be able to follow it and follow it properly so that, you know, people at home or wherever can understand it. And, you know, a huge discussion that's come up a long time over the years is, you know, people go to these sporting events and they watch them, and it's like, yeah, and I, you know what, I really enjoy watching it at home so much more. And I'm like, why is that? And they, well, I feel like I'm missing a lot. And I'm like, you have a point. You know, it's when you go to a live event, you can watch whatever it is you want to watch. But if you're going to be affixed to the Jumbotron and not look at anything else, then why go to the event? Because the bottom line is you're getting a lot more of what's going on told to you right sitting home in front of your TV set and watching from there. And you don't miss those things. But I think where people think they miss things when they go to the live event is because they become accustomed to seeing those images on TV, and then they go to a live event and they realize, oh, I don't have a commentator in my ear. I don't have...
Right, there's no story being told.
Right.
It's just the event unfolding in front of them.
Right. And so, you know, with that in mind, it's... There's two seats, and both have their place. But, you know, thank heavens that, you know, throughout the years, the networks and things like that have become so proficient at telling, you know, the sports stories and showing the games on TV and crafting them and advancing and coming up with new ways to get you into that moment or into the perspective that tells even more of the story, such as Skycam and for NFL games and so many other sports as well. And that perspective of, wow, I never would have imagined I could peek into the middle of a huddle just before they break to the line and then see from an elevated perspective what the quarterback's kind of vision is and how he's reading the field and can pick out his receivers. I mean, and it's just like an amazing wave of technology over the years in our industry has been mind-blowing. I mean, to when you started, when I started, which wasn't that much prior to you starting out, I'm sure. You think of where it was then to where it is now, it is truly an incredible feat, and it's just continuing to graduate in advance.
Now, tell our audience, there's some people in our industry that work all locally. They never get on an airplane to work. Myself, I started out working locally for like a few years in the New York metro area, but then I traveled 4 days a week on a plane.
I think you got hit in the head with that baseball a little too hard.
I did get hit in the head right there.
Oh my gosh.
How have you, what has your path been? Are you a travel only person, a local person, a mix? Tell our audience.
I'd say, to be fair, it's a pretty healthy mix of travel, even international when needed, to local. I mean, I've over the years, in terms of being a camera operator, I've always wanted to be exactly that, as a camera operator, but I'm not limiting myself to just a standard, you know, hard camera or a handheld. I'm also a jib operator. I also am proficient with robotic cameras. I fly drones now. I flew Skycam for 10 years on both sides. I piloted and I operated the camera. I just did another camera that was very similar to Skycam called Omnicam. I was also trained on cable cam and flew that system. But I mean, all these different things, someone came up to me and said, are you a camera operator? I'm like, yes. Well, all right, well, we need to put you here. And that happened to be a handheld. Okay, fine. I'm good with that. Or I need you to operate this hard camera. Okay, fine. I'm good with that. Could you do a pet camera in the studio? Yep, no problem. How about if I put you on this robo? The more you can say yes, I guess, to your craft and be good at it. I don't just mean say yes to put yourself, you know, one of my long time statements, and still to this day, is never put yourself in a position to fail. Now, a lot of people would look at that two ways and say, well, without failure, you can't achieve success. But there are times you don't want to fail, because that bad news will travel far quicker than you being good at something.
Yeah, I always tell people not to oversell yourself.
Right. That's a great, it's a really great way to put it. I think mine is more the black and white of it, and yours, it's a much, yeah.
Like if you want to take that chance and, you know, fail forward, be honest about your skills, be honest what you can do, but you are willing to take the chance and the opportunity, but just let the client or the producer director know that this is my experience, but I would love to take this opportunity and let them decide.
Perfect example. I mean, and, you know, we've all been in those situations where, you know, on hockey, sometimes there might have been a secondary, a tight follow position on a hard camera. And that's no joke of a camera to do. You have to be good with your skills to do it. And I remember years ago, with Dan Regan, we were doing a game, and all the other guys in the crew, and I walk up, and we're kind of, you know, standing around the truck and deciding what we're going to do. And nobody wanted to do the tight camera, and everybody kind of volunteered me silently. And I said, well, Scott, you're going to do tight. And I was like, okay. And I remember looking at Dan Regan, and I said, well, just so you know, I'm no Wynn Burnfeld. And he looked back at me and he goes, you're right. You are no Wynn Burnfeld. And I'm like, well, because no, who can be? You know, I mean, right. The guy could do it in his sleep. But, you know, kind of making that statement lightened the mood a little bit. And he knew. I mean, he knew whether I said that or not, that, all right, I'm going to give this my best effort. I'm going to be on point, and I try and get you as much stuff as I possibly can. And I think at the end of that, he was thankful. I mean, he didn't ream me, you know. There was, you know, mistakes will be made, but, you know, he moved on. And if anybody knows Dan Regan, great director, but can be volatile at times. So you need to be on point. And one of the things too is, in this business, whether you can do it or not, get a tough skin and don't take things personally, because a lot of times it's not meant that way. It's in the moment. You know, I've always said if I won the lottery for some ludicrous amount of money, like where I knew in my life I would never have to work another day again, I would want to work for every director I've ever worked for just one more time.
I got it.
But it's all good. It's all good.
Since you do travel somewhat for a living, favorite place you've traveled to?
I really had a good time in Japan. It was very eye-opening. I spent about a month there, and that was for the Olympics way back in 98. I loved London. Europe in general is really cool. But I've been in all different areas of London and Manchester, and it's just really, really just cool atmospheres. And the culture changes are so unique sometimes, and the experiences you take in from having traveled to those places, even though you're working, hopefully you have enough time to take in even more. And I think that regretfully, over the years, a lot of times when you start traveling a lot, one of your main goals is to let's get back home and enjoy our personal lives a little bit. And early on, when you're young, you're just like, let's go, go, go. But I was still always, when that job was over, I was ready to go. I was ready to get home. And I wish I had forced myself to always take, you know, another few days and just have my my own experiences and just experience things more outside of work than always under the gun with work. So, I mean,
No, I get what you're saying. I totally get what you're saying. Favorite event you've done?
I'd say I've always had wonderful experiences, and I think it's because of the amount of days that you spend on it is the Olympics. Right,
me too.
Any of the Olympics I've done, four of them, and every single one of them has been made great friends that, you know, years and years ago, and we're still friends today because of the long times that we spent together on these shows. And, you know, most of the time, and a lot of times, you show up on huge, massive crews such as an Olympics, or I used to shoot the Indy 500 every year for, almost 14 years. And that's a huge crew as well. And, you know, the last, I think, six of those years, I would do the whole entire month of May. But and events like that, where you're spending a lot of time with people you don't know when you arrive, you're very good friends with by the time you're done. And, you know, TV, broadcast TV, and this industry, you become one huge family.
Right, right, right. It's a small community.
It is. Big as it is, it's very small.
So we're in 2022. You've been in the industry for a long time. What advice would you give to Scott starting out back in 1994, 96?
See how much longer I could live with my parents, maybe? I don't know. no, truthfully, whatever formal education that you can get, take it and abuse it. Like learn as much as you can from it. Take supporting courses, because book knowledge is certainly very good, but you're going to learn a lot more out in the field as well. So your practical knowledge is also equally as important, but you need a vehicle, I think, to get you there. And it's harder, I think, now more than ever, to break into any industry if you don't have some sort of support to begin with, or I guess experience. And, you know, at least if someone was going to take a chance with you, I mean, how are you going to get an internship, you know, at a network if you're not going to school for it? I mean, I don't know many internship courses or programs that would take a walk-in, you know, off the street and say, hey, I just
want to work. Right.
So, you know, school is a great vehicle aside from what it could teach you in television. I mean, it's a great, just having a great education, because,
right,
because
you have to know how to, you know, balance your bank accounts, you know, how to go about, you know, making business and smart decisions. Right. Did you have any mentors when you started out?
Well, my biggest mentor was with Ron Cohen, and he was who I started working with. And I think after that, I mean, yeah, some people that I've met throughout the years who I've always looked up to, I think, we're equally good friends with him, is Gary. Oh my gosh. So you mentioned Teddy earlier, and friends for a long time. And I, you know, Gary just has an approach about the business and work in general, that I've seen over the years is like second to none. He's a go-getter, always has been, really knows his craft. He's a great shooter, and he's a good human being. He's just a good guy. So, he's not, you know, there's some of us in this industry who, you know, as the new guys come in, they're very paranoid or protective. Like, I don't want to show you, I don't want to teach you anything, 'cause you're going to take my job. And I think, Howie, you and I have talked about this before. You know, if you're that worried about someone taking your job, then it's going to happen. Be good at what you do. Be good at what you do, because your experience and your wealth or your worth to who you're working for should speak for itself. I mean, listen, there's quirky things across the board, and things happen sometimes that maybe shouldn't have. But, I mean, by and large, if you got knocked off the block by someone who's up and coming, it just means that you started slacking off. I mean,
right. And this is a, you know, perfect time to plug the course that you and I did together, where we trained, you know, a bunch of individuals, and we're going to do another one soon, the broadcast sports course. And a bunch of the people that we actually trained are in the business now, where we brought in, you know, we told them about the business, how to go about getting clients, who the clients were. And then we brought in the equipment and showed them how to use the equipment.
Right.
And constantly are speaking to them and giving them advice and mentoring them. And this is unfortunately not a field where you can get trained beforehand. There's no, you know, there's no apprenticeships. So a lot of it is on the job training. And, you know, if you're not willing to train other people to take eventually to take your spot when you decide to hang it up, then it's short-sighted.
Right. Oh, I couldn't agree more. It's a competitive market place too. I mean, it's that's why I say if you're going to be a camera operator, don't just stop at doing handheld. Learn other positions, and I think that's provided me a lot more opportunities over the years because I'm not going to just sit back and be a handheld guy. I'm not going to just sit back and be a hard camera guy because while they're all important positions, they're a dime a dozen when you start, you know, looking at the numbers.
Exactly.
And if you can do other things to stand out or to offer the uniqueness of an event and know how to run a camera that offers a unique perspective, trust me, there's not as many robo operators out there. There's not as many jib operators out there. There's a lot of them. Don't get me wrong, but
this is the perfect segue into what you do. So tell us about this picture.
This little bit of a monstrosity of a camera. It's from what we were just getting it kind of rounded out. Was used to shoot. I was DPing a B feature film last summer, and this is a red Komodo, I believe. Yep, it's a red Komodo, and we were just getting it set up on a shoulder rig, and you know all the extra GAC, and that's me kind of proofing one of the scenes, and Sean, the director, is standing behind me there, looking over my shoulder, and wow, that was a really concentrated look I had.
you brought up a great point earlier that you have to get involved with more than just being a camera operator, whether it's learning, you know, robos or if you're an EVS operator, being only an RO person, learning how to edit. If you're an A2, learning maybe to become a comms A2 or eventually an A1, because you don't want to get stagnant. You want to learn, and you keep taking it. You're like the prime example. You keep taking it another step further. You're a jib operator, and you, in the last few years, really took it to another level where you got into drone work. So explain that.
Well, the drone work, I mean, I had done a bunch of different helicopter work over the years. I mean, whether I'm sitting in the helicopter with it on my shoulder with a stabilized lens or putting on a Tyler mount. But coming out of my fourth year of shooting with Monday Night Football and Skycam, I was running the camera on that system, and I was done with Monday Night Football, and I started looking into some drone videos and stuff like that, and I'm like, why am I not doing this? Because it's kind of, you know, flying, you know, Skycam or Cable Cam or Omnicam is the same as a drone. It's just the drone has no wires. And so, I mean, almost 9 years ago.
Where is this footage being taken?
This is at Bannerman's Island, right on the Hudson River, here in our beautiful Hudson Valley. And this was taken just a few weeks back. I was doing some promotional work for the island itself. It's an old ammunition castle. It used to be a residence, and it's now in, restoration process. And this particular shot I shot just the other day. It's involved with a project with the a New York State Bridge Authority and a conference they have coming up in 2024. But also, this is the Bear Mountain Bridge, and it's turning 100 in 2024. So this is all acquisition and asset gathering to create that video for the project moving forward. And this is just a quick shot that I had sent to you the other day that I thought was a lot of fun. And we, thanks to you, Howie, we had gotten an opportunity to shoot down in New York City, or actually in Jersey, for a celebrity golf match, an Icon sports event. And we provided all the drone coverage for the celebrity golf tournament itself. And we went out very early. This is all shot at sunrise from the Jersey side, and got them some stock footage of our beautiful Statue of Liberty.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Starting at sunrise, and just, you know, some of the stuff you capture. I mean, I'll watch it twice, as I watch it while I'm doing it. And certainly by, you know, watching the frame and everything like that, and all the telemetry and other things I have to pay attention to. Then I go and transfer the footage and look for it back, and I have to clip stuff off. And I'm like, who shot this? I don't remember, you know, 'cause some of it just turns out it's so amazingly beautiful. And this was at this year's SummerSlam down in Nashville, Tennessee, which we also did some interesting perspective from FPV drones. And we had engineered a whole sequence for the open of their show and a teaser leading into SummerSlam that was pretty amazing. Fascinating. And word of encouragement, the kid that we worked with for the FPV, I mean, Todd and I can both do FPV, but this kid doesn't sleep. So we brought him in. He's still going to the University of Syracuse, and he did all our FPV stuff for the show down there. And it just, man, it turned out so incredibly great.
Explain what FPV is.
First person perspective, first person view. So when it goes flying around and through things, it's that very first person. And this is some of the work that I flew for SummerSlam itself, and showing off and showcasing their fireworks display and how their event looks, you know, all set up. So, yeah, a lot
amazing,
of fun,
Scott.
In the drone world, and some thank you, Howie, and cutting edge. I mean, that is a part of the industry that didn't really exist quite a few years ago, and now it's becoming a broadcast. I'm not going to say standard, but you see a lot more drone work and broadcasts nowadays. And with the advancement in technology and how the drone world is advancing, not just on the broadcast end of things, but for other things in general, such as municipalities and safety and photogrammetry and mapping and all sorts of amazing technology with drones. It is becoming very popular in television now too, because it's for a lot of things that don't need, there's tools for every job. And I don't think it's eliminating the helicopter perspective, but there are a lot of things that a drone can do for an event that a helicopter can't. And,
exactly.
And vice versa, you know, to be transparent on that. But if you're on that technology wave and you embrace the technology rather than fight it, it can open up a lot of doors for you. You have to stay with it. I mean, I would have to say I'm definitely one of the pioneering people in the drone aspect of things, where I was doing it before anybody else even really knew what it was. And I felt like I was late to the game, because there were people that were obviously in front of me on that, but I stuck with it. And while it's not something that I can just say, this is all I'm going to do is drone work from now on, it does supplement, you know, a lot of the work that I do. And they're good. They're cool projects. I mean, it's not just
absolutely
one off. I mean, it takes time, and there's paperwork involved and coordination and shot engineering and stuff. But, you know, to have the confidence to be able to sit on the phone with a director or producer and say, absolutely, we can do that.
Or no, we can't.
Or right. That might not be the best approach for it. Yeah.
Right.
And maybe
we have time for one more question. Your favorite part of working in the sports broadcasting industry?
I think the memories and the friends that I've gained over the years has been uplifting for me. I mean, you can't imagine the amount of people you meet in the course of a career in this line of work. I mean, you really do. You make friends if you're, especially if you are not just a local market person and you get on a plane and you travel, you will make friends all over the country, if not all over the world. And
it's so true.
And those experiences and friendships that I have gained, and I say gained because I truly do value the relationships that I have with people. And it is one of, you know, the things that you can't remove from your existence in this business. I mean, not everybody's going to like you and not everybody's going to hate you or anything. So hopefully you can fall somewhere in the middle of that. But just be respected and you'd be surprised at how much that lends you in terms of developing relationships with people, and not just for work, but for life in general. So I have to say that's, I think, one of the most valuable assets, other than it certainly paving the way for me to pay my bills over the years has been great. But it's not the sole purpose. And I think as you get into whatever job it is that you do, whether it's in this industry and others, that you start to, you know, mature into what becomes valuable to you. And yeah, the almighty dollar speaks volumes, but what else can your career add to your life other than right. just financial gain? And I would have to say it's that the personal relationships that I have developed over the years with people have been what I value the most. And awesome.
I couldn't agree anymore.
Yeah.
Scott, we really appreciate your time. Good luck going forward. You've done some awesome stuff, especially all the drone footage. And we look forward to seeing more.
I hope there is a lot more to come. Many more chapters to get through in our lives. And I will just say this, and incredibly proud to have watched you just go through your career. And certainly by no means are you at the end of anything. But you know, the relationship we maintained over the years, and
absolutely,
you know, sometimes we aren't talking, you know, every day or every month, or even, you know, at points that we weren't talking, you know, every year, right. just kind of get caught up in our careers. But every time we come back together, it was always fun to catch up. And I am thankful that we get to work and speak absolutely. Together much more often now. So thanks for having
absolutely.
Me. This was a lot
thank
of fun.
You, Scott. Thank you.
TV Crew Talk is brought to you by Ferdinand the Fur Dresser, a children's book by Brian Nolay. Available at Amazon and at www.briannolay.com. Also by the Broadcast Sports Course. Accelerate your career in just 2 days with an intensive boot camp. Learn how to break into sports broadcasting and discover the keys to building a successful career from industry veteran and Emmy Award-winning camera operator Howie Zales. Take one step closer to your dream career. For more information, go to www.broadcastsportscourse.com.